In today's world, we see bombs, we see missiles, we see drones. But what if the next global conflict is fought with something much smaller, something you can buy for $10? Right now, as we see conflicts all over the world escalate, it's more critical than ever to understand how digital weapons operate. What if I told you that a simple, unassuming USB flash drive caused billions in damages and crippled a nuclear program for years without any explosions? Hi, this is Carsten from Hacking Matters, where each week we look at the best practices in cybersecurity. Today we're breaking down how a $10 USB flash drive allegedly delayed Iran's nuclear program without any bombs. Most people think of hacking as stealing data or looking up files for ransom. But imagine a scenario where a small piece of code delivered invisibly cripples a nation's critical infrastructure. Not just Iran's, any country, setting back strategic programs by years. That's not science fiction. Today we're looking at the story of Stuxnet. Stuxnet was a malicious computer worm, first discovered in 2010, but active from at least 2007. What made Stuxnet so unique? It wasn't designed for data theft. Instead, Stuxnet specifically targeted industrial control systems, often called PLCs, or programmable logic controllers. These automate giant machines, industrial processes like gas centrifuge that separate and thereby enrich nuclear material. But PLCs are also used everywhere else, really. Stuxnet was very advanced at its time. Today we see other forms of malware adapt some of its techniques, in particular those used by state spies, but also increasingly by ransomware gangs. That makes the lessons from Stuxnet as relevant as ever. Unlike many cyber attacks, Stuxnet was not designed to spread over the internet to its targets. It ended up spreading accidentally anyway, and that's why today we know about it and can talk about it. Instead, Stuxnet was meant to spread via flash drives, USB devices. And that's key because it allowed Stuxnet to jump over air gaps, reaching highly secure networks that were completely cut off from the internet, like a secret nuclear weapons program. Once it infected a Windows computer, Stuxnet would then look around for a specific piece of Siemens software that was controlling the PLCs. And if it didn't find the Siemens software, it would just spread to the next and the next and the next computer and always try again to find that software. Even after finding the Siemens software, it did some additional checks. It was specifically designed to target specific industrial motors, and it would only attack systems that spun at a certain very high frequency that supposedly is exactly the frequency that you use for gas centrifuge, the ones in nuclear enrichment. And that's probably why Stuxnet didn't cause much damage outside of its intended target, even after it accidentally spread over the internet. Stuxnet operated for at least 3 years inside the nuclear enrichment facility, which is insane given how tight the controls were. So the genius of Stuxnet really lay in its ability to lie to human operators. It would infect the control software, intercept signals between the control software and the PLCs, change them, but report back to the human operators what they expected to see. So it was hiding the information that came back from the machines. And so the human operators saw on the screens what they expected to see. So human operators saw on the machines what they expected to see, while in the background, the machines slowly destroyed themselves. And that happened by Stuxnet spinning up the motors and slowing them down, spinning up, slowing them down. So over time, not just disrupting the nuclear enrichment, but destroying the actual machines. The primary target of Stuxnet is widely expected to be the Natanz facility in Iran's nuclear enrichment program. And the outcome, allegedly, was very significant. Stuxnet destroyed about a fifth of the nuclear enrichment capability, and that's thousands of physical machines that were degraded and unusable. This slowed down the enrichment itself, but also tied up a lot of resources in investigating why things kept failing. So overall, the enrichment was slowed down by several years. Stuxnet was highly sophisticated, but the lesson it teaches us are more universal for anyone interested in cybersecurity, really, whether you're defending something critical infrastructure or just a corporate network. Stuxnet highlights how physical damage can be caused by digital code. And that's why Stuxnet story is still so very relevant for us in cyber today in multiple ways. First lesson learned, you can't protect from Windows 0 days. Stuxnet had several of them in it, but you are as likely to experience a 0 day on the internet today. They happen once in a while and they often break into many, many computers all at the same time because patches are just not available yet. But aside from patching, the control that you really want to look at here is endpoint detection and response, EDR, or maybe in a managed way, an MDR. And those help you to block threats based on behavior, not based on known threats. So 0 days can be caught by EDR solutions. So you want to combine this with strict application whitelisting on your most critical systems to ensure that even if a 0 day exploit is triggered, the attacker doesn't have many places to go because their ability to execute code is severely limited. Stuxnet was also a harbinger of today's destructive malware and ransomware. It transcended data theft and aimed for damage, in this case, physical damage. It underscored a crucial shift, which is still ongoing today, where defending for threats designed against operational destruction is much more challenging than defending the confidentiality of your data. And today's best practices, of course, have adopted to some extent, but are still relatively more focused on confidentiality than resilience. To increase your level of resilience, your first call of action is to make your backups ransomware-proof, so you have a fallback option. We have a whole video on ransomware-proof backups. Stuxnet reminds us that business continuity hinges not just on preventing attacks, but also recovering on them swiftly. Took Natanz 3 years, apparently, to finally get rid of Stuxnet. You don't have 3 years, so you need to have incident response procedures much quicker than that. Lastly, and perhaps the most enduring lesson from Stuxnet, is its leap across the air gap. You might rely on some level of network segregation, but no network is better segregated than an air gap network. And yet, it didn't hold up to a persistent, determined threat. So don't rely on network segregation. In most ransomware cases, and certainly in our red teams, we notice that we do breach multiple network boundaries who are supposed to be segregated well from another. And so it is in hackers' playbooks today. These are the lessons learned from Stuxnet that still apply to IT and OT security today. Stuxnet was unique in one more way. It was a highly targeted operation that accidentally leaked onto the internet for the world to see and for us to talk about it. We must assume that many similar operations have happened and stayed hidden, and that the craft of state espionage and state sabotage has only progressed further in the 2 decades since Stuxnet was developed. To conclude, Stuxnet reminds us that cyber is not just about data, it's about physical impact. And the line between digital and kinetic warfare is increasingly blurred. In our next video, we dive further into OT security and how to tackle the challenges with today's cyber defense toolbox. If this video helped you understand the implications of cyber sabotage, please show it with a like and subscribe. Drop a comment below if you have any questions or comments. Tell us, what real-world cyber incident would you like us to break down? Until next time, happy hacking.